We have a demonstration that shows how this works, because you might be asking, how does that protein get into the chaperone protein? How does the unfolded protein get into the chaperone protein? So I need somebody to come up and be a chaperone protein. Anybody want to be a chaperone protein today? Yes. Okay. And I have a piece of pipe insulation. Okay, if you hold this and hold it open. Okay. Just hold on. You don't have to hold it to, yeah. Okay, so here is a piece of pipe insulation, and this is my protein. It's folded. It's a single polypeptide, and it's folded in its correct conformation, and the conformation is dictated by the interactions of hydrogen bonds, by interactions between the R groups. And if the temperature goes up, say, this protein can become unfolded, and if it becomes unfolded, so a bond breaks, then what happens is a site is revealed that you didn't see before it was unfolded. This site has a similar site on the chaperone protein, and so now this protein that was merrily floating around with this site actually hidden is now exposed. It now can go into here, it gets dumped in here, and we shake it up and we try and make a new protein. We try and make it refold correctly. Okay, so just a minute. I have one more thing for you to do, but it will just take a second. Okay, so what then, in fact, not all proteins, when you put them in a chaperone like that, the chaperone doesn't always work. It can't always help the refolding of the protein. So if the protein is damaged or misfolded and it can't be recovered by the chaperone, then it's actively degraded. And that's what I told you in the first clicker question. That's what Irwin Rose and his colleagues here found, was that it was actively degraded, and that degradation depended on interaction of the protein with another tiny little protein called ubiquitin. Any protein that was misfolded gets tagged with ubiquitin. It's called the kiss of death. If you actually Googling kiss of death, you will get ubiquitin. And that is what allows this to get delivered to a proteasome, which is the cell's garbage disposal. And that contains proteases that chop up the protein into short peptides. So what bond is it going to be breaking? Peptide bonds, exactly. Okay, so now we have a proteasome here. Looks much like our chaperone, but it's not exactly like it. And this chaperone didn't do very well. It actually didn't allow this one to refold, so it's still exposed. And in fact, there's another site exposed. This site is the site that will bind ubiquitin. They're these tiny little molecules. They're proteins as well. They bind. And not only do they bind, you get actually a whole stack of them. Somebody did a demo of this last year. And one of the things that they did was they, in their practice with me, they put ubiquitins all over the molecule. In fact, there are particular sites where the ubiquitin binds. And then you get a long string of them that attach together like this. And now there's an enzyme that recognizes this ubiquitin tag, sticks it, grabs onto it, brings it over to the proteasome, dumps it in there, and now it shakes it all up, and out come what? Right, small peptides that can be reused. And so, actually, I did one thing wrong. Okay, very good, thank you. One thing, which is the ubiquitin tags. Yes, thank you very much. Ubiquitin tags that are on there, they actually get removed before the protein goes into the proteasome, so they get recycled. These peptides get recycled and get reused, so this is kind of the ultimate green machine, right? It's recycling all of these molecules so they can be reused and made into other things in the cell. Okay.